Well, students, this is the second lecture on the chapter of semiconductors. In the first lecture, we had, if you remember, we had studied about the band theory of solids, in which we said that a solid has different bands called as conduction band, valence band, and the gap between them is called an energy gap. And then, based on this band structure, we had classified the solids into three different categories called as conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. Now, we are going to proceed further in this chapter. We are going to concentrate further now only on semiconductors. So, in this lecture now, we are going to study about the different types of currents, the current which can exist in a semiconductor. We are going to study an important phenomenon called as drift. Now, this is something which you have already studied, but we are just giving it a different name. Okay? So, what is a drift? What is a drift velocity? What is a drift current? This is what we are going to study in this lecture. Okay? What is drift? So we have a semiconductor over here. Okay, we have a semiconductor across which there is a voltage V which is applied. So we have a voltage V which is applied across the semiconductor. You can see here. So this is the semiconductor and we have a voltage V which is applied there. Now what is inside a semiconductor? There are electrons and holes. Okay, both exist. Electrons as well as holes, both are the charge carriers inside a semiconductor. So now when we apply a voltage V, there will be a current flowing in the semiconductor, current I. Now, this current I is basically due to the movement of electrons and holes inside the semiconductor. So when you apply this voltage V, the electrons move towards the positive terminal, towards the left hand side, whereas the holes which are positively charged, they move towards the negative terminal, towards the right. So electrons negatively charged move towards the positive terminal. Holes which are positively charged, they move towards the negative terminal. Now this movement of electrons and holes, when we apply a voltage or potential across the semiconductor, this movement of electrons and holes is called as drift. So we say that the electrons and holes are drifting. Electrons are drifting towards the positive terminal, holes are drifting towards the negative terminal. So, this is what we say. So, what is drift? When a potential difference is applied across the semiconductor, the electrons and holes start moving towards the positive and negative terminal respectively. And this motion of the charge, which arises because of the applied potential, is called as drift. So, we need to keep in mind over here, why are the electrons and holes moving? Because of the applied potential. So that is what is causing the electrons and holes to drift. So drift motion is possible only when there is a potential difference applied across the semiconductor. Next, what is drift velocity? Now, the velocity, the speed with which the electrons and holes are moving towards their respective terminal, positive or negative terminal, the speed with which they are moving is called as the drift velocity. So the electrons are moving this side. With what velocity are they moving? The holes are moving this side. With what velocity are they moving? That velocity is called as the drift velocity. And last important thing is, what is drift current? Now, electrons are moving, holes are moving. Movement of charge is nothing but current. So whenever charges move, it results in a current. So the movement of these electrons and holes, which were produced by the applied voltage, this produces a current in the semiconductor, which we call as the drift current. So what is drift current? Drift current is the current which arises in a semiconductor because of the applied potential across the semiconductor. Okay, so the current which arises in the semiconductor due to the application of potential difference, voltage, across the semiconductor is called as drift current. We now define an important parameter regarding a semiconductor, and that's called as a mobility. What is mobility? Mobility is defined as the ratio of the drift velocity attained by the charge carriers to the electric field applied across the semiconductor. Okay? So the ratio of the drift velocity to the electric field applied across the semiconductor is defined as the mobility mu, okay, denoted by the symbol mu. So mu is defined as Vd, which is the drift velocity. Okay? Vd is the drift velocity. And E is the electric field which is applied across the semiconductor. Now, what is this electric field? What is this electric field? Electric field is nothing but, if you remember, electric field E is voltage upon distance across which the voltage is applied. So if V is the voltage applied across a body and the d is the distance across which the voltage is applied, then the electric field produced is voltage upon the distance applied d. Okay, so in the case of the semiconductor, the voltage applied is V and the distance across which the voltage applied is between these two points. It's basically the length of the semiconductor. So here d is nothing but the length of the semiconductor L, which we'll be seeing later on. Okay, so electric, so remember, whenever there's a voltage applied, there's an electric field. If voltage, there was no voltage applied, V was zero, then electric field also would have been zero. So we can interchange between voltage and electric field easily. Okay, one and the other, they are basically almost the same, except for the constant D which is there between them. So we can always interchange between electric field and voltage. So whenever there's a voltage or whenever there's electric field applied across a semiconductor, there is a drift current. And the ratio of the drift velocity to the electric field applied is defined as the mobility mu of the semiconductor. Now, why this name mobility? Why is it called as mobility? In English, we know what is the meaning of mobile mobility, something which is free to move. So this mobility mu of the semiconductor basically is a quantity which tells us whether the charge carriers inside the semiconductor are more free or less free to move inside the semiconductor. So greater the mobility means the charge carriers, electrons and holes inside the semiconductor are more mobile, they are more free to move. Okay, so therefore, if they are more free to move, naturally they will attain a higher velocity. When you apply a potential or when you apply an electric field, they will attain a higher velocity because they are more mobile. So naturally, mu will be higher. Okay, so mu is Vd upon E. So if Vd is higher, if the charges attain a higher velocity for a given applied electric field, then the mobility will be higher. So that's how this definition takes account into that. Okay, higher the value of Vd, more will be the value of mobility. So remember, mobility is a parameter of the semiconductor which tells us how free the charges are to move inside the semiconductor. Now, what will be the units of mobility? SI units of mobility are meter square per volt second. Now, how do we get this unit? It's very simple. We can get the unit of this mobility based on its definition. Mobility is drift velocity divided by electric field. So if you put the units of these two quantities there, so mobility mu is Vd upon E. Now, what is Vd? Vd is the velocity, some kind of velocity. What are the units of velocity? Units of velocity are meter per second. And it's divided by electric field. Electric field, I told you, is here. It is V upon D, voltage upon distance. So what are the units of voltage? Units of voltage are volts and units of distance are meters. So it's volts per meter. Electric field units are volts per meter. So if you combine these two things, you will see that you get the unit as meter square divided by volt second. Okay, volt second. So meters goes up, it becomes meter square, seconds comes down and it combines with volt. So you get meter square per volt second. So that's the units of SI units of mobility. Meter square per volt second. CGS units will be centimeter square per volt second. Instead of meter, we replace it with centimeter. Okay, so that's about mobility. So please note this important definition. Mobility, we'll be using this quantity mobility in the further parts of this chapter. Okay, so mobility is drift velocity upon electric field. And as a summary of this slide, what is a drift, what is drift velocity, what is drift current? All these things arise because of the applied voltage, applied electric field. So whenever you apply electric field or whenever you apply a voltage across the semiconductor, the charges start moving. This movement is called as drift. The velocity with which they move is called as drift velocity. And the current which arises because of this movement of charge is called as drift current. So proceeding further, we are now going to have a derivation. We are going to have a derivation which is going to show us that the mobility and conductivity of a semiconductor are directly proportional. And it is quite simple to understand why. Because what does conductivity tell us? Conductivity is opposite of resistivity. So if conductivity is high, it means that the resistance is less. Now what is the resistance? Resistance is nothing but opposition to the flow of current. Opposition to the flow of current is called as resistance. So now if resistance is less, what does it mean? That the charges are free or are the charges free to move or difficult to move inside a semiconductor? If resistance is less, means the charges are more free to move. So they will have a higher mobility. So if mobility, if resistance is less, automatically it means that mobility of the charges is higher. So conductivity is high means resistance is less means mobility is high. So conductivity and mobility should be proportional to each other. So that is what we are going to show in the next derivation, that conductivity of a semiconductor is proportional to the mobility of the charge carriers inside the semiconductor. So for this, we have here a rectangular semiconductor, having length L, length of the semiconductor is L, and its area of cross section, this cross sectional area is A. So in other words, the volume of this semiconductor, it's a rectangular semiconductor, the volume is nothing but length into breadth into height. But breadth into height is area. So volume will be length into area. So that's the volume of the semiconductor. Now what have we applied across the semiconductor? We have applied a potential, a voltage V, because of which there is a drift current I which is flowing through the semiconductor. Okay, so now we have a semiconductor of length L. Then area of cross section is A. And N, let N be the concentration of free electrons inside the semiconductor, So small n, remember, is the concentration of free electrons. Basically it tells you what is the meaning of concentration. It is the number of electrons per unit volume. So concentration of free electrons is N. Now remember, in this semiconductor there could also be holes, because always in a semiconductor two type of charges exist, electrons as well as holes. We'll be doing this derivation considering only electrons in the semiconductor, and later on we are also going to extend that to the holes existing in the semiconductor. So N is the concentration of free electrons in the semiconductor. Now if N is the concentration of electrons, what will be the total number of electrons inside this semiconductor, total number of free electrons that we can obtain as N, total number of free electrons in the semiconductor, N will be equal to concentration into volume of the semiconductor. Now how do we get this thing? Because if you remember, how do we define concentration? Concentration is number of charge per unit volume, amount of charge per unit volume. So concentration is number of charge N divided by volume. So what will be the number of charge then? It will be concentration into volume. So which I can write it as equal to concentration of the electrons inside the semiconductor is N, and volume of the semiconductor, as I said earlier, it is A into L, area of cross section into the length of the semiconductor. So it is N A L. Now what will be the total charge, due to these electrons, due to the N, capital N number of electrons present in the semiconductor, what will be the total free charge in the semiconductor? Total free charge Q will be number of electrons, which is N, into charge of each electron, which is E. So this is the total free charge due to the electrons inside this semiconductor. So what will this be? This will be equal to, if I put the value of N there, it is N A L into E. So this is the total charge inside the semiconductor. Now what have we done to the semiconductor? We have applied a potential V across the semiconductor, because of which there is a current flowing in the semiconductor. Okay, drift current flowing in the semiconductor. Now what is the formula for this current? I can write, so because of voltage, because of potential difference V applied across the semiconductor, current I flows in the semiconductor. Okay, and this current I can be written as I is equal to charge upon time. The definition of current, current is defined as rate of flow of charge. So charge per unit time is current. So I can put the value of Q there. Q, we have written the formula here. It is N semiconductor and t is the time. So distance L upon time is nothing but a velocity. But what velocity is this are we talking about here? It is nothing but the drift velocity of the electrons. Okay, remember electrons are moving towards the positive terminal. The length which they are traveling is L and the time taken for this movement is t. So L upon t, distance traveled upon time taken, is nothing but the velocity, and in this case it is nothing but the drift velocity of the electron. So I can write this as equal to n a e into vd. Now what is vd? Vd is nothing but the drift velocity. What is vd there? Vd is L upon t is the drift velocity. Okay, so that's how we get this equation 1. Okay, so now this is the current which is flowing in the semiconductor. Now I'm going to move one step further and I'm going to write a formula for the current density. Current density is denoted by the symbol J. So we have I, we have already obtained I in the previous formula. I'll write it again over here. I was NEAVD, NEAVD. So I'll rewrite it over there. I was NEAVD. Now I'm going to write current density, a formula for current density. Current density J is defined as current per unit area. Okay? And we have already expression for current there, so current upon area will be just NEVD. Okay? So this is equation 2. Okay? Now, why have I written a transform from current to current density? If you see, current, there's A appearing over there. Current depends on the area. Current in a body depends on its area of cross section. Greater the area of cross section, more will be the current flowing through that body. But current density, on the other hand, if you see the formula for current density, it is NEVD. There's no formula for, there's no A coming in the picture there. So what does it mean is that current density is a quantity which is independent of the area of cross section. So whether the body has a small area of cross section or a large area of cross section, the current density in both these bodies will be same. But what will be different in both these bodies? Current will be different. The smaller body will have a lesser current, the larger area of cross section body will have a greater current in it. So current depends, changes from body to body, depends on its physical dimensions, its area of cross section. Whereas current density is independent of the area of cross section. So we can apply this current density to any body. Okay, it is something which is common for any object, any area of cross section. So that's why it is more better to write in terms of current density than in terms of current, because current applies only to one body, current density applies to any body. Anyway, if you want to find current, if you know current density, and if you want to find current, all you have to do is current is J into A. So it's a very simple calculation. If you have current density, you can always find the current in the semiconductor. So that is J, so this is equation 2. Now how have you obtained this formula for current density? Remember, this first expression for current density we have obtained using the definition of current. Current is charge upon time. But now, current can also be obtained using Ohm's law. So there's another way we can obtain current. So using Ohm's law, what will be the formula for current? Current is I is equal to voltage upon resistance. V is equal to IR is the Ohm's law. So current I will be voltage upon resistance. And this I can write it as equal to V upon rho L by A. Now if you remember, resistance R of of any body can be written as rho L by A. What is rho then? Rho is the resistivity, L is the length of the body, and A is its area of cross section. So resistance is rho L by A. So this I can further write it as equal to, so A goes on top, so V into A upon rho L, and this I can further write it as equal to, now 1 upon rho I can write it as sigma, conductivity. 1 upon resistivity is conductivity. So I can write this as sigma. 1 upon rho is sigma. Further, V upon L. What is V upon L in this formula? V is the voltage applied and L is the length of the semiconductor. V is the potential which is applied and L is the length of the semiconductor. Basically, it is the distance across which that voltage is applied. So voltage upon distance is nothing but electric field in the semiconductor. So this I can write it as E. Okay, what is E? E is the electric field. It is voltage upon the length L. And finally, A. So just write what we have used in this calculation. 1 upon rho here is written as sigma, which is the conductivity, and V upon L is the electric field, E in the semiconductor. Now, so this is expression for current. Now, we can also write in terms of current density the way we had written for the earlier expression. Current density J can be written as J is equal to I upon area, current per unit area. So this you can write it as I is sigma EA. So current divided by area, A will go from there. It will be just sigma into E. Okay. So this is your equation number 3. So we now have equation number 2 is expression for J, NEVD. And also from equation number 3, we have another expression for J, which is sigma into E. Both are expressions for current density. They have been obtained by two different ways. One is obtained by a definition of current, charge upon time. And the second one is obtained using the Ohm's law. But they are both expressions for current density. So we can equate them. Equations 2 and 3 can be equated to each other because the left hand sides are both J. Right hand side of this is NEVD. Right hand side of this is sigma E. So we can equate sigma E with NEVD. And we can write it as sigma into E is equal to NEVD. Okay. This is from equation 2 and 3. So we have equated equations 2 and 3. And that's how we have obtained this equation. Now, we are interested in expression for conductivity. The aim of this derivation is to obtain for a formula for the conductivity sigma. So what is sigma therefore from this? Sigma is then NEVD divided by E. So this is the expression for sigma. And finally, what is VD upon E? VD is the drift velocity and E is the electric field. If you remember the definition earlier, drift velocity upon electric field is nothing but the mobility. So we have N, E, mu. How do we get this? Because VD upon E is defined as the mobility mu. So we have sigma is equal to N, E, mu. This is the expression for conductivity sigma. You can see, as I told you earlier, conductivity and mobility, they are proportional to each other. Okay? So greater the mobility of the charge carriers, electrons or holes, greater will be the conductivity. That is quite simple to understand why I told you earlier. Because greater mobility means electrons are more free to move in the semiconductor. More free means what? They have a lesser resistance. Resistance is less. So resistance is less means conductivity will be more. Okay. So now, this is the expression for, general expression for conductivity. This is, as I told you earlier, we had considered only electrons in the semiconductor. But in the semiconductor, there are also holes. So there are also holes which we can represent it by the concentration P. Okay? N is the concentration of free electrons and P is the concentration of holes in it. So this expression is taking into consideration only electrons. But in a semiconductor, we have to consider both the things, electrons as well as holes. So for electrons, therefore, we can write this as sigma E is equal to N E mu E. Now what is sigma E there? Sigma E is the conductivity due to electrons. Conductivity due to electrons. And what is mu E? Mu E is the mobility of electrons. In a semiconductor, the mobilities of electrons and holes are different. Okay, so we have derived this general formula and then we have customized this formula for electrons. Similarly, for holes, what will be the conductivity of holes? Using the same general expression, sigma is equal to n e mu. For holes, the expression for conductivity sigma h will be p e mu h. Now, what have we done there? N has been replaced with p, because what was n there? N was the concentration of electrons. Whereas for holes, the concentration of holes is p. So we replace n there with p. And mu is replaced with mu h, where mu h is nothing but the mobility of holes. So we have here, what is sigma h there? Sigma h is the conductivity due to holes. P is the concentration of holes. And mu h, it is the mobility of holes. Okay, so we have expression for conductivity due to electrons and conductivity due to holes. The total conductivity of the semiconductor will be a combination of this, a sum of both these conductivities. So total conductivity sigma of the semiconductor, sigma total I can write, will be equal to sigma conductivity due to electrons plus conductivity due to holes, because both of them contribute. Both this electrons as well as holes contribute to the current, contribute to the conductivity of the semiconductor. So what will this total be? It is sigma E was N E mu E, and sigma H was P E mu H. So this will be the total conductivity, sigma total. Now, we are going to consider a special case of what is called as an intrinsic semiconductor. What do you mean by intrinsic semiconductor? It is a semiconductor which is pure, there is no impurity in it. And what is special about the intrinsic semiconductor? The number of electrons and the number of holes in it are equal. So in other words, concentration of electrons and concentration of holes is same. So n is equal to p, small n is equal to small p for an intrinsic semiconductor. So with that special case, so for an intrinsic semiconductor, for an intrinsic semiconductor, we have n is equal to p, concentration of electrons is equal to concentration of holes, and we'll write it as equal to some common value. Well, that is ni, intrinsic concentration. So ni means intrinsic concentration of charges, either electrons or holes, because both are same. So with this substitution in this sigma, total conductivity, I can write it as sigma I, where I represents, sigma I represents there as the intrinsic conductivity. So the total intrinsic conductivity will be, we replace here n with ni and also p with ni, because both are equal. So this will be ni, if I take it common from both these things, it will be, and e also you can take it common from both of them, it will be just sigma mu e plus mu h. Okay, so this expression for sigma, this expression for sigma changes into this one only for a intrinsic semiconductor, which in which both electrons and holes are equal in number. Okay, so this is a special case formula. So now we have written down expression for conductivity sigma in a semiconductor. We're going to just move one step forward and also write an expression for the current density, okay, G, in this current density due to electrons and current density due to holes. Because remember, in a semiconductor, there are two currents which contribute to the total current I. Total current I is current due to electrons plus current due to holes, because both of them are moving. When you apply a voltage, electrons also are moving, holes also are moving. So the total current is due to the combination of electron current and hole current. So expression for current density. So J, we're going to use this formula for J as sigma into E. We're going to use the general expression for current density, and then we're going to write formula for current density due to electrons and current density due to holes. Now, where did I get this formula from, J is equal to sigma E? If you see, by doing the derivation, we had obtained it. Okay, where is that? Here, equation number 3, you can see in the derivation, J is equal to sigma into E. So using this expression, We are going to write a formula for current density. Yeah. So J is equal to sigma into E. This is a general expression. So using this general expression, I can write for electrons, current density due to electrons, JE, current density due to electrons, is sigma E into E, where sigma E is the conductivity due to electrons. What you have done here? You have just put subscripts over there, JE and sigma E. So this will be equal to what? It will be N E mu E into E. Okay? So this will be the current density due to electrons. And for holes, what will it be? Current density due to holes will be using the same expression. Using the same expression, it will be JH, current density due to holes will be sigma H into E. Now what is sigma H? We have written sigma H is P E mu H into E. So this will be the current density due to holes. And the total current density in the semiconductor will be how much? Total current density, J total will be sum of current density due to electrons plus current density due to holes. It will be JE plus JH, which will be equal to N E mu E into E plus P E mu H into E. This is the expression for total current density. And last thing, special case for intrinsic semiconductor. For intrinsic semiconductor, what we have? Concentration of electrons N and concentration of holes P are equal. So that is equal to Ni, we have seen it earlier. So we can write Ji, intrinsic current density, will be, if I combine all of them and write it together, I can write it as E E into Ni in brackets mu E plus mu H. This will be the expression for intrinsic current density. How did we get this expression? We got it from this. How did we get it? If you see in both this expression, small e and capital E are common, which I have taken out there. And further, N and P are both equal to Ni, because number of electrons and number of holes are same for intrinsic semiconductor. So N is equal to Ni, P also is equal to Ni. So we have taken Ni also common out there, and what remains is only mu E plus mu H. So this is the expression for current density in an intrinsic semiconductor, pure semiconductor without any doping. If you have doped, if you have impurities, then which expression for current density are you going to use? You are going to use this one. Okay, this expression. This one. For intrinsic, it is this one. So that is about the conductivity of a semiconductor, the current density in a semiconductor. So this is what we end the first part of this chapter with, the current existing in a semiconductor when you apply a potential. It's the drift current, and we have obtained expressions for this drift current. Though they are in terms of current density, you can always write in terms of current by multiplying with area. Current density is current upon area. So current is current density into area. So you can always write these formulas in terms of current. So we'll stop with this over here, and we'll in the next lecture we're going to proceed with another, the second part of this chapter, which is a phenomenon called as Hall effect.